don't have time for this. I got to get my student ready for a recital each, you know, twice a year. When am I going to find time for improvising or composing? But I would argue that, in fact, it saves you time in the long run because students retain concepts when they have to take ownership of them. And the second reason is that it keeps them inspired. When they can keep something, when they can take ownership of something and create something and get their hands dirty in music, they're less likely to quit lessons. They're more likely to want to practice. They're more likely to leave inspired. So here's the teacher accompaniment from my own song. It's very new agey. And the student's just gonna improvise on the two black keys. Yes, question, comment.
Yes, just on that. One of the things I do with that is play a game called Monkey See, Monkey Do. So we put the disc, or the recording on, okay? And I play a little rhythm, and then they copy the rhythm. Then I play something else, they copy. Because a lot of times they're just like, just do quarter note. Or they have no clue yet at this point. So we get, and I hit the two, black keys together and go bump, 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 and then they go bump, bump. And we play the whole song that way. And then I say, now go home and try to create something. Yeah. And that gives them some direction because they really are like lost, as to what to do, And they always only come back with just quarter notes.
Yes.
And just one note, and then another, and then one note, So this game, we play Monkey See, Monkey Do first, and then they go home, and then they work on it.
Beautiful. Love it. You're jumping out ahead of me, but I love everything you're saying. And that's great. One of the things that I feel like some other improvisation methods don't do well, grammar, is that it's just a matter of putting your fingers somewhere and wiggling them. And when I teach improvisation, I like to always give them something to do. And usually it's something about rhythm or something about phrasing, because otherwise you get what you're referring to, which I refer to as just musical diarrhea. That is just... right? But of course, we want to keep elevating the level of your improvisation. So doing some imitation is a great way to start that. And I'll tell you some other ways that you can provide some limits on improvisation so that they're actually learning something and not just wiggling their fingers.
It seems like they need a little something to get those juices started.
Yeah.
You know, it's like really, because they right away think, I can't do this.
Yes.
And so then, yes, you just get the back and forth like this. But it's just a beautiful thing to see them blossom through that. And it gives them confidence then. I can make some music. This is really great. But they do need something to get those juices.
I agree, yeah. Especially some come and just aren't ready to do it, and some need something to unstick them from that element of I can't. Yes.
Conversely, I also like to use it to help students learn steady beat, because if I have a student who comes in and can't do steady beat, I say, oh wow, you're using jazz rhythms, that's really cool. And then I say, now let's play it once with steady beat, and then we'll use your jazz rhythms for a variation. Mm. So that way they also learn about form.
Nice. I love that, when they have bad rhythm, you say, oh, what a master of syncopation you are. What fascinating polyrhythms you use. Okay, so I'll show you a little something from book B. So this is still part of Hal Leonard level 1. And it presents the grand staff. So now students are starting to get notes on the staff, and it presents the grand staff as this musical map. You can see it looks like they're going to search for pirate treasures in here somewhere. And so, again, immediately you're reinforcing it with some workbook type exercises, although very colorful. You have a little piece called My Best Friend. I'm just going to roll through this. And so you have a piece called Tambourine Tune. I'm going to play it for you. Here it is without teacher accompaniment first. And then with teacher accompaniment, it sounds something like. Mm-hmm. they do an activity page with tambourine tune. And I love this. So it asks them to name the notes, and then it asks them to perhaps make a variation. And so the directions just direct them to write in the notes that are given here, but I like to tell them to scramble the notes to make their own variation. So it's a very simple exercise, but on a very basic level, they're actually kind of composing, right? And this is one of the best ways to get your young students to be creative, that you have to fool them a little bit. You give them enough material that they don't feel like they're pulling something out of thin air. You know, that's what you never want your student to do, is just be staring at a blank page and say, compose something. But if you can give them, okay, here's six notes and a rhythm, what's the order? That's something that they can certainly do for themselves. And so you can keep loosening the qualifications on them to take them from something so clear and easy to do like this to something maybe a little bit more complex. So through book two, they're working on the staff, they're getting through a couple of time signatures, they're doing some basic playing around middle C. Books C and D are now vertical, and these make up Howell Leonard level two. So again, you just need to use two books instead of the five that you might use. And in book C, they're introduced to the concept of the fourth, and there's a really cool activity that I'm going to show you. So there's a piece called Hoedown that uses fourths. It's very Copeland-esque. Here's without the teacher compliment. And with the teacher compliment, I think this is a great accompaniment. Sunlight Through the Trees. This is one of the great pieces where the student's supposed to keep the sustain pedal down the whole time, like which they often do whether they're supposed to or not. So at least this time you get to tell them, okay, do it. Sounds like this. Connecting between fingers, brain, ear, and heart. This shows a lot about the interval of a fourth. The fourth has this wide open sound, and this piece demonstrates it so nicely. So you're able to connect an emotional kind of feeling with what they might know about a fourth, which I think is really cool. Then there's an activity page for Sunlight Through the Trees. And what the student's directed to do is the piece is then divided into these 10 portions, and the student's asked to take a scissor to their book, which they love doing, cut out these 10 pieces and put them in a different order and come up with their own piece. Which again, very simple, but kind of what composing is sometimes, right? And I met a teacher in Peoria who took this activity, and she would have a studio class night where all the students would cut it out and put it in their own order, and then they'd each play their new piece so they could hear what everybody else came up with, which I thought was a pretty fun little idea for a studio class. So that's another kind of activity you get. And lastly, I'll show you something from book D. This is where they're teaching about flats, and they have this piece called A Little Latin. Has anybody used this piece? This is a well-loved Howell Leonard piece. It goes like this.
Favorite one.
I'm trying to get all the hits. There's so many hits. Thanks for bringing that up. So there's, again, an improvisation activity. And by book four, the improvisation's gotten a little bit more complicated. The directions here say, let your hands talk to each other. So the student's going to trade phrases between their left hand and their right hand. And again, this helps bridge the gap a little bit between just there's nothing to do and there's so much to do. So when the hands talk to each other, that means you have to kind of play in phrases. Each one has to have a beginning and an end. You have to listen to yourself and to one another. So this is a nice place to start with improvisation. So you get this nice... This is actually a 12-bar blues form. So the teacher gets to play the 12-bar blues and the student will improvise. Using both hands. I'm going to pause for a second and give you my little 12-bar blues lecture, if you don't mind, because I think For people who are at all interested in jazz or improvisation, it's good to have a basic understanding of the 12-bar blues. So what I want to tell you is the three reasons why the 12-bar blues is different from everything else that we do in Western music. Okay. Number one, let's see how good the ear training is out in Wisconsin. What kind of chord is this?
Dominant seventh.
Dominant seventh. Ding, 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 you win. Okay, and what do we usually expect dominant seventh chords to do? We expect them to resolve, right? We hear this. In fact, if I play this and leave the room, somebody probably has to run to the piano. Goodness, right? But not in the blues. In the blues, we use dominant seventh chords as our tonic sound. Doesn't sound like it needs to resolve. That's your first reason why the blues is weird. Second reason is that in music we expect phrases to be built in multiples of two. So we have the musical period, a two-bar phrase, plus a two-bar phrase equals how many bars? Four, that's right. A four-bar phrase then is married with another four-bar phrase, and we get eight measures, an eight-measure phrase, and another eight-measure phrase, we get 16. So we skipped 12, which is the number of bars in a blues. So a blues has 3 4-bar phrases, which is very unusual. And so one way that you can get students to improvise with the blues and make sure that they're learning is to ask them to improvise an AAB blues. And this is a one-time only thing, Facebook live stream. I don't want this shared anywhere. Here's an example of an AAB blues. Oh, my baby left me. She left me yesterday. Oh, my baby left me. She left me yesterday. So that was 2 A's, now I'm going to do something different for the B. She left me to go to Milwaukee. Right? And you can do that, of course, with a melody as well. And now something different for the B. Students is that they have to play something memorable enough and simple enough in that first A that they can remember it and repeat it, yeah. Right? Which gets rid of that threat of musical diarrhea because you'll be able to say, well, you couldn't remember it. It must not have been a very memorable phrase. So it makes them simplify. Third reason the blues is unlike any other form of music is that typically in music we have one scale for one chord. We have a C major chord, we use a C major scale, we go to A minor, we use a minor scale. Okay, you get me, there are 3 different minor scales we could use, but we go to D minor, we're using a D minor scale. But for the blues, we can use this scale, the blues scale, for the entire form. Even as the chords change, we can just keep using this scale. In terms of teaching improvisation, this is great because we don't have to worry about our students keeping the form, changing scale, knowing what chord they're on. they can just get this set of notes and use it over and over again. So this is why, for the improvisation on A Little Latin, we can just give them a few notes, and we know even though we're changing chords, they're still gonna be fine. So those are the three reasons why the 12-bar blues is different than other forms of music. Okay, so those are some ways in these all-in-one piano lessons that Hal Leonard sets you up as a teacher to engage with them creatively, to engage their ear, their heart, their brain, as well as just their fingers. I want to talk about a couple other more recent books that came out that also could help you out. I love this book. This is called A Piano Teacher's Guide to Creative Composition. This is by Kara Closey. How many of you teach composition in your studios? A few of you. I love when I ask that question. Nobody actually raises their hand full ways. It always is like, I kind of do. I don't really call it teaching composition. So if you do it, or if you'd like to get better at it, this book has a lot of resources in it. So there are, I think, six parts. Part one is laying the groundwork for creative composition. So how do you get started? As I said, one of the most scary things can be just seeing that blank page in front of you. So she gives you a lot of ideas, from singing to working with a text, to telling a story or thinking of an emotion, to starting with a chord progression, or starting with a theory concept that you want to write something that, you know, involves dominant seventh chords. So there's all these different ways that we can try to get students writing. The second chapter, I'm not going to skip over, is a student's library of compositional tools. And so this chapter has things like different kinds of left-hand accompaniments a student might use, different popular chord progressions or ways to spice up those chord progressions, different melodic characters. Here's a pro tip in composing or in working with a student composition. Most of them will write immediately by step, almost exclusively. And what you need to do is encourage them to add some skips into their melody. Right, because all of our most famous melodies have skips, kind of. And it's those skips that really have the emotion, right? Or even, right. Students will also usually start right on the beat. Right on beat one every time, because that's where it looks like music's supposed to start if you have a piece of staff paper. But again, we know that a lot of great music starts with pickups or after the beat. So basically in part two, she's got all these kinds of tips for ways which a student who might write a certain composition might be able to vary it a little bit and spur some new ideas. Part three is mapping a composition. And this is a nice way to show your student what they're doing well and what they're not doing well. Because it's very hard to teach composition, because you don't want to say, that's bad, what you did creatively was bad. But you might be able to say, you know, well, we only have these two different chords, look at this graph. Or the melody never really leaves these three notes, look at the graph. So this is a nice way to just show them where they're balancing in the variety versus cohesiveness scale. Now the best part for you all is chapter four. What does this say, Eileen? It says lesson plans. So the way that the book is designed is that you could incorporate composition into your lesson plans to get two complete compositions, one for each recital, a winter recital, and then a spring recital. And so it has lesson plans as to what you might do with a student each lesson to keep them writing, so that you don't have to think about it. And then lastly, it has a chapter on polishing and refining a composition. And I think this is really important because you want your student to take a sense of pride in what they've written, especially if they're going to perform it in public. So I personally think that it's fine to either guide the student through a refining process or to do some refining yourself, to add a few fancy chords that you know about, to add a few different kinds of left-hand accompaniments that you know about, so they can just boost it up a little bit and they can perform something that they feel really proud of. So those are a few things that are in Piano Teacher's Guide to Creative Composition, a very useful book to have in your studio. We have this is a pretty new book from Ruth Price, who teaches piano, I believe at Washington University in St. Louis. I'm sorry, Webster University in St. Louis. And this is an approach to teaching repertoire and to studying scores. And it's a nice way to introduce repertoire to your students. And I'll show you a couple of the chapters how it works. So it starts with the example of this very first Beethoven sonata. And it has a three-step approach. Step one is ask yourself, what is the character? And you could do this with your students. So, yes?
What's the title of the book?
The title is Right Before Your Eyes. Okay. So I'm going to play it one more time and think about the answer to the question, what is the character? Anybody? You look like you're anxious to say something. No? Go ahead.
Agitated.
Great. Great word.
Excited.
Yeah. Yes.
Joking.
Oh, cool. Yeah, we so rarely think about jokes in minor, but there is definitely an aspect of that. Yes?
In a hurry.
In a hurry. Okay.
I was going to say capricious.
Capricious. Beautiful. Wow, this is such a great group. Okay, so step two is once you've kind of decided on a character or a group of characters, what in the score creates that character? Now, you can't see the score, so you're going to have to trust me to play it relatively accurately. but see if you can answer that question. So what's there that's creating the character? Yeah.
There are turns.
Okay, yeah, the turns. How do those contribute?
There are more sounds, which immediately engages the thought, oh, something's going on.
Yeah, okay, cool.
Almost a panic.
Yeah, love it. Yeah.
Well, I say the speed, the rising melody, and the minor.
Okay, yeah, so the tempo, the fact that the melody is rising.
Yeah.
And what was the second thing? What was the third thing? And that is in minor. Okay, the key. Yeah.
Anything ascending accompaniment.
The ascending, yeah.
Two chords.
Yeah, beautiful, especially at the end, that chromatic rise. I think the other thing about the accompaniment is that there's those repeated chords, and those have a certain insistence to them, right? Yeah, what can you say?
The upbeats.
Right, it doesn't start right on the beat, it's not ba 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 ba. Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool, great. And then step three, ask the question, what does this imply for my interpretation? So what should you do as a result of thinking through those first two steps? That might be different than what you might have done if you didn't think about it. Any ideas? Oh, this is where they're stumped. Is your hand going up yet? Yeah.
Make it sound like you're running away from somebody. You're danger coming in.
Yeah, okay, great.
Crisp, firm, crisp sound.
Right, yeah, you probably don't want to massage the piano too much if you're going to really look for that character. Yes?
Really follow the dynamics.
Yeah, okay, so, and here there aren't dynamics until we get to fortissimo, but we probably want a crescendo,
right?
And if we were going to slow down or speed up, which would we do?
What do you mean, what does it imply? Like, what should happen next if you heard this? What should happen if you want to hear next?
What should it imply for your interpretation?
Oh.
How might you interpret it differently?
It would be increasing speed and increasing
velocity. Right, exactly. So if you're looking to give it a feeling of agitation, you wouldn't want to slow down. You'd want to maybe speed up just a little bit, right? You maybe want to crescendo a little bit. You want to make those staccatos extra short. You'd want to give a shape to each of those lines. Da, 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 da. Those repeated chords, they don't have a dynamic, but you might want to make each one a little bit louder, right? So if you think through these things, it can connect that hard aspect for the students to what they might end up doing with their fingers. So I think that's a really nice way to think through a piece. But there's a lot of other kind of fun chapters in this book. One is called, I Hate This Part. the subtitle is Zen and the Art of the Awkward Passage. so it talks about what to do when your student says, I hate this part. I like this title. Which came first, the climax or the forte? I can see you thinking. So this is, if you want just a little bit of a refresher in terms of the way that you teach repertoire, this is a nice book to get you thinking in a slightly different way. So that's, again, it's Right Before Your Eyes by Ruth Price. How am I doing for time, Cindy?
Oh, you're good. You have an hour.
I still have an hour.
You do.
Can we all give Cindy a hand while she's here? She does such a great job setting this up. Okay, so in that case, I want to talk with you a little bit about the Journey Through the Classics series. Does anybody use these in your studio? Oh, you have a few. Okay, good. So the Journey Through the Classics series, I always get the question in pedagogy classes and things like this, how do we get out of lesson books and into repertoire? And the answer is with the Journey Through the Classics series. This starts students from places where they could easily play from a lesson book, but every piece in here is not an arrangement. These are original pedagogical pieces by really great composers. This is a big deal in Hal Leonard. It was a couple years ago anyway. I didn't know that there are actually music publishing awards. And these are called, get this, they're called the Paul Revere Awards, because apparently he was actually a music publisher himself. Which led my friend to make the really lame joke. One if by land, two if by middle sea. No, don't leave. So what I want to do with these, since I know a few of you are familiar with them, is that I'm going to walk you through them as books, but I want to talk about one of our most creative piano pedagogues. How many of you are familiar with Abby Whiteside? Oh, a few of you. Okay, cool. So Abby Whiteside was the first to say quite a few things that we take for granted now. One of the things that she said is that rhythm, in fact, should be at the center of pedagogy, not notes. She said that just because our fingers are the part, yeah, getting an ovation from the back. She said, just because the fingers are the part of the piano touching, or the part of our body touching the piano, it doesn't mean that they're the only part of the body to move, or the only part of the body that should be trained. She has this pedagogy that's based not from notes to expression, but from expression to notes. Again, it starts with the heart, rather than starting with the fingers. So what I want you to do, what I want to do here is I'm going to show you a few pieces, and I'm going to show you some Abby Whiteside teaching tricks. Now, if you're interested in learning more about her, she has several books published. Her name is ABBY, and then it's like the word white, W-H-I-T-E, side, S-I-D-E. And her books are really lovely, and I happen to be the grand student of Abby Whiteside. I studied with her last living student, Sophia Rozoff, who's now 94 years old. So I feel really lucky to have actually inherited some of this tradition, and hope you'll allow me to share it with you. Yes?
I went back to school when I was 35 to get my music degree, and I was experiencing a lot of difficulty with sluggish fingers, and I read Abby Whiteside's one of her books, and that really turned the corner as far as me being able to play fast and gracefully.
Oh, that's fantastic. I'm so glad to hear that. I have to say that they're one of the things, I know sometimes it's very easy to get frustrated in teaching piano, especially to young students. Has anybody here gotten frustrated teaching young students? Yeah, oh, the hand goes right up in back. Whenever I read Abby Whiteside, it's a refresher for me. It reminds me why I do what I do, why I think it's important to teach music. So if you're in that need of a pep talk and something to kind of keep you going and to inject a little bit of energy into your teaching, her books are really inspirational in my mind. Yes?
Are they published?
So, yes, they are. Some of them are out of print, but one of the things that the Abby Whiteside Foundation did is that they sent them to virtually every library across the United States. So even if you can't find them in print, I know many of them are available on Kindle now, and you can go to your local library and find them. And this is not a Hal Leonard plug, by the way. They're not through Hal Leonard or anything like that. This is just something I'm passionate about. So Journey Through the Classics, like I said, these are all original pieces by real composers. I've had students who really value that. They want to see those years and say, oh, Michael Praetorius wrote this 1571 to 1621. So it starts just in C, five-finger position. Here's the first piece, Renaissance Dance. Thank you. I really certainly would expect that anybody out of Hal Leonard book B would be able to do that. If they got out of D, then this would be like way too easy for them, right? The next piece is follow the leader, and I'll take this opportunity actually to show you an Abby Whiteside technique that we can use with really young students. And it's called splashing, okay? And the way that this works is that you direct your students to play all of the emotions, every part of the music, except for the right notes. So this is a very unusual way to introduce a piece to a student. Because the first thing we want, generally, is the notes. But Abby Whiteside would say, that's not necessarily true. We have all these other things. We have rhythm, we have dynamics, we have expression, we have phrasing, etc., etc. So I'm going to play this next piece, Follow the Leader, splashing first. It's not going to be too pretty. And then I'm going to show you what the piece actually sounds like. Okay. The music was all there already. All you had to do was put in the right notes. How hard is that? Okay, I'll show you how far we get at the end of book one. We're still mostly in C major. We do get out of the five-finger position a little bit. Things get a little bit more active between right hand and left hand. So here's a Gavotte by James Hook. And I'll show you. Rather than, you know, sometimes they get their second finger into position, and then their fifth finger, and then their third finger. This gets them to find it immediately. But for me, it also makes melodies sound more of one piece, rather than note by note. This is one thing Abby Whiteside talks about a lot, is that note by note music is not very interesting. It's not music, right? We don't want our students to hear phrase-wise, to hear that entire phrase. So what we do is that we put groups of notes together as they naturally want to fit. So here, instead of